Before I begin, I would like to thank Lau Kinchi for inviting me here. I'll be presenting some of our projects and processes during the workshop on architecture and urbanism over the next few days, but I'm really glad I could attend this forum. I'll be taking back a lot from the conversations over the last 2 days, and I hope to be able to contribute in some measure through this process. This is a work in progress. So I've been trained as an architect, and I work in informal settlements in Indian cities. Most of the work we do is in facilitating self-construction. I think this is not new for you, but informal settlements are self-created by people because there is a lack of affordable housing. So people are creating their own solutions by building their own affordable housing. So these could be slums or what are called slums, unauthorized colonies and urban villages. So I work in facilitating this process, but also hands-on building projects such as schools and daycare centers. And most of the work is in collaboration with lawyers, social workers, activists, because many of these settlements are considered illegal. So it involves a lot of activism and rights-based work. So I'm going to be talking about the urban context in the workshop, but today I'm sticking to the rural context. 70% of India lives in its villages. And this example or this story is from Keonjhar. That's a district in Odisha, in southeast of India. So the villages here are inhabited by indigenous communities, and they are classified as PVTGs, or potentially vulnerable tribal groups. The reason for this classification is because of the improvement, quote unquote, improvement of the conditions, and also because of the low indices of, again, quote unquote, development. Their indices of their so-called development. The kind of work, so first I have to talk about the organization that I work with there. They're called Kirti, Keonjhar Integrated Rural Development and Training Institute. The kind of work they're doing there is rights-based, especially when it comes to land rights, because a lot of the land of the tribals has been illegally acquired by the government, the state government, politicians, and private companies. And the reasons for this are obvious. The whole concept of land titling is something which came with the colonizers, the British, and even though the land has belonged to them for generations, and today it's really a form of neo-colonization with everyone, this whole network that I was talking about, the government, the private companies, and politicians working together. And one of the other sort of works that the NGO, which is doing some really incredible work, the work they do is also in an alternative path to development. So today development, I think world over, and at least in my country, is understood as you live in a concrete house, urbanization is seen as development, you have a washing machine, you have an air conditioner, a car, and you have arrived. And if you get more developed, then perhaps you realize that actually this is not very sustainable, and then you go back to the traditional practices, the more sustainable practices. So the idea is how to circumvent this whole absurd cycle and really retain what we already have, which makes logical sense. So the kind of work they're doing, for example, is in the realm of farming. A lot of us have talked about that already. So organic farming. Some farmers are already practicing organic farming, but many have stopped doing that over the last few decades. Also, companies like Monsanto are a huge problem because the kind of seeds that now, because of commercialization of agriculture, that the farmers are buying do not yield new seeds. So that means you have to buy seeds every year, which is leading to impoverishment of the farmers who find themselves stuck in a cycle of debt. And there are lots of farmer suicides all over the country. So what does an alternative path to development mean in the context of architecture is what I hope to bring to this conversation. So first, let's look at the indigenous, the traditional vernacular architecture of the area. It's built in the local materials that are found there, so mud, thatch roof, or clay tiles. beautiful mud plaster, beautiful colors of the five kinds of mud that are found there. And the communities, this is a Juan community. The village is from a tribe called Juan, and they've been living in harmony with the ecology, their livelihoods, and because of the architecture, also responding to that sort of ecosystem. But also because of the illegal land acquisition, they're facing problems in so many different ways. For instance, the loss of habitat of the animals leads to animals then coming to their villages and their farmland, and then elephants trampling over their fields. So architects really like graphics. So there are a lot of graphics in my presentation. No words, sorry about that. So this is a traditional house. These are the houses for the goats, the cows. And looking at the community spaces, how do people come together? This is a community center, a mandaghar, and then more incidental spaces such as the space around a hand pump, more event-based spaces such as an open-air stage, a mandap, something called a doli, which is a ferris wheel, which is used during fairs, and then that thing in the middle is a machan, which is used for looking over your farms, so that animals don't trample. It's not a community space, but it's really nice, so we've put it here. And this is what a community center, this thing on the top left corner, typically looks like in traditional architecture. It's the most important space, really, in a village, which holds the social fabric of the community together. And what is it? I will just quickly talk about the various elements that make this community space. There is a holy fire in the center of the community center, which is always lit. It's always burning. It's a sacred fire. So if there is a guest to your village, then you take the flame and you cook with that flame and you cook over that in your stove. There are drums called changu. The Juan tribe is known for playing these drums, making these drums. So those are exhibited inside the community center. And also grain reserve. So after every harvest, every family donates a bit of grain so that in case of emergencies, everyone can use them, or whoever needs that can use them. And then there is a shrine to Mother Goddess, which is always outside under a tree. And of course, the meeting space is the most important, where the elders of the community, get together, discuss, serious matters, or you're just passing by and you stop for a chit chat. There's always someone sitting there, and the youngsters are responsible for the upkeep of the community center. So, male adolescents, young boys are responsible for collecting the firewood every day. The girls are responsible for cleaning the space and the upkeep of the space. So all these elements come together to make a community center in every village. But what has happened over the last few years due to our housing policies is that, before I come to that, I need to just give you a bit of a background very quickly. In 1985, this was a year after I was born, and the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was assassinated. The Prime Minister then, her son, introduced a social welfare scheme for rural India called Indira Awas Yojana. And the scheme provided financial assistance to rural India, to households in rural India, so anyone could upgrade their houses or build new houses. So the guidelines have revised several times, but essentially what they say is if you're living in a kacha house, kacha is Hindi for temporary, then you can upgrade to a pakka house. Pakka means permanent. But what they define as kacha or temporary are materials like mud and stone, which is essentially all of the traditional or most of the traditional architecture in India. And what is pakka, no points for guessing, is concrete architecture. So this, you can imagine what this led to. What this led to is more concrete construction all over the villages instead of traditional architecture. But I think more importantly, what it did is really undermine the importance of traditional architecture, in which it is seen as poor, as temporary and not durable. And pakka, concrete is seen as something which is modern and also developed. So today, the community centers in these villages look like this. So this community center has been built by demolishing a traditional community center. And what has happened is the fire, the holy fire, cannot burn inside a concrete community center because the roof is made of metal, of GI sheet, and it becomes sticky. The fire cannot burn inside the space. So what the people have done is they've shifted the fire outside in many villages, and the grain bank, the grain reserve, has shifted to another concrete building, which is called the grain bank. The shrine is still where it is, and the drums have really become ornamental, and it's mere tokenism because no one meets there anymore. It doesn't feel like a community space, and it's hardly used. This is something we realized. So I was talking to a few people there with the help of Kirti staff, and what we started realizing through the conversations is that they started realizing it themselves when we were asking about, you know, what is a new community center, which has been built at different times for different villages over the last, let's say, 5 to 7 years. What, you know, how often do you use it and do you like it? And they started realizing that actually they don't meet that often anymore. They don't have so many meetings anymore. So what that has really done, the national housing scheme at the community level has not just disrupted architecture but also how people live and an erosion of their culture. In some cases, 3 minutes, okay, perfect timing. And slow down, okay. This is usually, I mean, this is slower than I usually talk, but I will slow down even more. In some cases, what people have done is that they have been able to retain the old community center, and they've built the new community center because they had space, so in another space. So they have both old and new, and the new is used for just storing grains, and the old one is used as it has been used for generations. And then there was a third case that I saw in one of the villages, which is a hybrid really, which means that the concrete construction was the foundation, and up till the sill level, the window level, was all concrete, and above that was traditional architecture, so in wood and clay tiles. And the reason for that, I realized, is that the contractor, the middleman, who is really the link in this whole ecosystem of construction, was from the village. That means that either he was sensitive to, you know, what a community center means to the village, or he was able to have discussions with the people from the village. And this made me realize that, and it's a very well-used space. Here it's hidden behind a tree, but you know, there are all these people there. When I went there, there were a lot of people as well. And this made me realize what really, you know, could be a solution here. So this is the last slide. So as architects, you know, your first impulse is, okay, you know, I can perhaps design something, build something, and then, you know, you start realizing with time and, you know, with, I think, good collaborators, that sometimes it's good to not build. And what we realized is a good, you know, approach here is perhaps to have discussions, simply, you know, people be able to speak to each other about, you know, what could be done here. And as an architect, perhaps I could bring the tools that I have been trained in. So we like making models. So that's this is a picture from another project, but just to illustrate what could be the sort of process. So like I said, it's an ongoing process. We are still in the middle of this for a new community centers that could be built in the future. As a last 2-3 concluding thoughts, I just want to say, I mean, not only is it a good idea because people and decide for themselves what they want to do, but also it is not my role to tell them what is good for them, because because of where I come from, being an urban bred architect with all the indicators of what, you know, is seen as development, to say that, you know, this is not development, you deserve better development. Secondly, also because traditional architecture is not, the younger generation doesn't feel the same about building a traditional way, because traditional architecture requires constant maintenance. It's something which changes with time. You know, you have to keep adding to it, you have to keep evolving it, and concrete requires no maintenance. And when I say younger generation, I speak for myself as well. You know, it's just we want something which is fast and quick and doesn't require a lot of work. So what's the sort of you know, approach that you want to take can only be decided through a conversation between the elders, between the younger generation, and that's what we're hoping to do. The last thing I want to share, am I still within time? Okay, is that the link really here? Because we're talking about national schemes, and then what can we do at a community level? The latest scheme, Prime Minister Awas Yojana, under the current Prime Minister, has actually revised the definition of what is temporary and permanent, but the damage has been done. It has been done over decades. So the only, I think, subversion is possible at the grassroots level. And if, you know, examples from one area can be shared with adjacent or geographically distant areas. So the link here really is also taking into the loop, let's say, different stakeholders, such as the junior engineer who's responsible for approving the design and also releasing the money. And that's what we're hoping to do next. And on that note, I will conclude. Thank you. Thank you very much.